nerve that we have, all the political stuff that's happening in the country that wants to keep us back as black and brown folks, all the things that our families have done, the experiences we've had, children have done, and let's shed all that stuff and give God the highest praise. Then we'll say God is great and greatly to be praised. Glory, glory to his name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, because this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and I will be glad. And then I thank the Lord, I thank the Lord, I thank the Lord. Because we have a spirit of thank you this morning, a spirit of gratitude. So join in with us as the choir brings the praise and worship and gives that sacrifice of praise unto the Lord this morning. Amen. We ask that you stand with us, sing with us, clap with us, and the Lord leads you to run up and down the aisle, speak in tongues, do whatever God has you to do. Let's give up that praise this morning. All right. Come on, choir.
Rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous. The counsel of the Lord standeth forever. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord altogether, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance. Amen. We now stand for hymn, page 6, hymn 222.
This far by faith.
For all those who can, we ask that you remain standing. Please turn to page 7 for our scripture reading, Genesis 12, verses 1 through 4, the New International Version. The Lord had said to Abraham, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the peoples on the earth will be blessed through you." So Abraham went as the Lord has told him, and Lot went with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. Now have our welcome by Brother Clarence Oliver. You may be.
Good morning, Second Baptist Church.
Good morning.
First of all, I'd like to welcome our guest speaker, Reverend Williams, all the way from Willingboro, New Jersey.
Right.
And what a lovely picture this is in the bulletin. Okay, if there are any visitors in the house, would you please stand or wave your hand?
Amen.
Would you like to say a few words? Yes, sir. Well, welcome. Now, I would like to say one thing. I'd like to thank all the people who have given me prayer during my surgery and recovery. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Announcements for today. Pick up your Bible class sheets for the evening Bible class at the usher station. Calling all singers, has the Lord blessed you with a voice to make a joyful noise? We need you. Even if you can't commit to every Sunday, please consider blessing us when you are able. See Dr. Ford, Deacon Harris, or Deaconess County. The following will be closed for the month of July and will resume in August. Sunday school, noonday Bible class in the building, Christian Caring Helping Hand, Edith Douglas Food Pantry. V&A at Second Baptist of Asbury Park is now open for the month of, for July. Tuesdays, 10 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. No appointment necessary. And for our July birthdays, yesterday, July 15th was Ronald Lucas. The 17th, Frederica Blue on the 17th, Rima Joseph on the 18th, Sandra Harris on the 20th, Jemiah McGill on the 22nd. Men's Weekend Retreat 2023. Iron sharpens iron. Any man interested in the men's weekend retreat, Friday, September 15th through Sunday, the 17th, see Deacon Williams after service. To contact our interim pastor, Dr. Gloria White Allen, please call the church office at 732-774-5347 to schedule an appointment. There will be a church meeting after service on Sunday the 13th. Thank you.
Thank you for the announcement. At this time, we are inviting you to come to the altar for prayer. Or you can just stand where you are, but I'm asking everybody to stand, please. Father in heaven, we are so grateful that you've allowed us to be here today. We thank you, O God, for waking us up this morning. We thank you for traveling mercies as we set out to come to this church called Second Baptist Church. Father, we ask and we pray that you will continue to have mercy upon us. We pray, O God, that you will forgive us of our sins, our many sins, O God, and help us, O God, to be strong and to just to love you and to not commit the same mistakes over and over again, oh God. We pray, oh God, for our families, every family that's represented. We pray for them, oh God. You know what they need, oh God. You know what is lacking in that home, oh God. And we pray, oh God, that you would just have your way in their life, oh God. We pray, oh God, for the children, that you would just bless them, oh God. Give them wisdom, give them understanding, and help them to realize that they too must be saved and receive Jesus Christ as their Savior. So we ask, O God, that you would touch their lives, O God. And we pray for those who are hospitalized, O God. We ask, O God, that you would touch them, O God, and we pray for them, O God. We pray for the doctors and nurses, and we pray for all who will be attending to them, O God. We ask and we pray that you would just have mercy upon them. And Lord, we pray for our sister Griffin, oh God, who had a memorial service for her husband on yesterday. And we thank God that she's here today, oh God. And we just ask and we pray that you will strengthen her body, oh God. Help her, oh God, to realize that you are still in control of every situation. And we thank you for that, oh God. So, Father, we pray for those who are not feeling their best today, oh God, but yet they pressed out anyway and came to Second Baptist Church. Perhaps there's someone that's watching us, oh God, through video, and we pray for them as well, oh God, that you would just watch over them and give them what they need. We pray, Father, that those who are not well, that you would heal their bodies, oh God. We pray, oh God, that you would just watch over them. And we do pray a special prayer for Dr. Allen, oh God, that you will just continue to watch over her and keep her, oh God, and strengthen her body, oh God, and make her, oh God, make her a strong instrument for you, oh God. We know, oh God, that whatever's attacking her, oh God, we know that you have all power and you can overrule that attack, oh God, and you have that power, oh God. We know, oh God, that we can do all things through Christ. And we know, oh God, that we just trust you. And we know that everything will be all right. So we thank you for that, oh God. We look forward to you, oh God, and to in our lives, oh God, and to watch over us and to give us what we need. So we ask, oh God, that you will strengthen us and keep us and guide us, oh God. And Father, those who are before the altar, you know what's going on in their lives, oh God. We pray, oh God, that you would just move in their lives in a special way, oh God, that you will give them what they need, oh God. And we pray that you will strengthen them, keep them, guide them, give them what they need, oh God, that you will be honored and glorified through their lives, oh God. So we thank you, oh God, thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you, oh God, for just allowing us to to have a closet that we can pick, choose what clothes to wear today, oh God. And we thank you for the variety that we have, oh God. And we thank you for that, oh God, for making it possible. So we know, oh God, that all things come from you as are good, oh God. And we thank you for that, oh God. So we ask, oh God, that you will continue to bless this church, Second Baptist Church. Lead us and guide us in the way in which you would have us to go. That you, oh God, will be honored and glorified as a result. For this is our prayer in the name of Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you. miracles, never alone.
Church, it's offering time. As we ask Brother Ron Lucas to come forward and our deacons to prepare the table for our offering. Those who do not come this way, we also have Second Baptist. You can also go on PayPal. You can also pay by calling someone up, one of the deacons or one of the ushers, and have them just come to your house and pick up God's money. Thank you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Thank you for the acknowledgement. My birthday yesterday, I was out in the yards pulling weeds and stuff like that. But it was a great day. That's what we do. Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you again for the chance to come and gather and worship your name. I'd like to ask a special blessing for two of my former co-workers that passed away last week at ship fires. Be with their families as they go through this grieving period. They were good guys. I worked with them personally. So just please just be with them. Now, be with us as we lift this offering up. Bless those who can give and those who can't give. May we use these funds to continue the operation in this location. These and all the blessings we ask in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning, Second Baptist Church, and to God be the glory for all that he has done and will continue to do. Allow me this opportunity this morning to introduce our guest preacher of this morning, Reverend Janiqua R. Williams from the great city of Willingboro, New Jersey. Once again, welcome her mother, Sister Jenkins. Amen. A servant of Jesus Christ and a minister of the gospel, the Reverend Janiqua Williams has been blessed to serve God's people for many years in a variety of capacities and settings, including in churches, ministry conferences, nursing homes, hospitals, and in the community. Reverend Williams is an associate minister at Parkway Baptist Church in Willingboro, New Jersey, part of the American Baptist Churches of New Jersey, which is affiliated with the American Baptist Churches USA. At Parkway, she serves on the pastoral ministry team and the worship production team. She also serves as the superintendent of church school, manages the church social media presence, supports the music ministry and prayer ministry, and teaches a weekly adult Bible study. Previously, she served on the diaconate board as well. Reverend Williams was elected to the executive committee of the Greater Delaware Valley Association of the American Baptist Christian United Jersey on April 2023, serving as the GDVA's representative to the Region Committee on Professional Ministry and Church Relations. An ordained American Baptist pastor, Reverend Williams also supports the ABCNJ region through Pulpit Supply, the monthly regional prayer meeting and interim ministry. She also preaches and leads worship at least once a month for the chapel service at Riverview Estates Nursing Home in Riverton, New Jersey. Professionally, Reverend Williams has a vibrant career spanning more than two decades in various communications. She has held positions as newspaper reporter, public relations associate, a corporate communications manager, and owner of a small Christian PR and marketing communications firm, and as an adjunct professor at both Rowan College at Burlington County, formerly Burlington County College, in Pemberton, New Jersey, and Eastern University at St. David's, Pennsylvania. Several years ago, Reverend Williams moved into full-time professional ministry. Currently, she works as the manager of the Pastoral Care Department of Capital Health Regional Medical Center in Trenton, New Jersey, where she provides the vision, strategy, and implementation for the pastoral care programs that support patients, families, and the hospital staff. In the community, Reverend Williams has volunteered for the Burlington County Domestic Violence Response Team, served as a Burlington City Police Chaplain, and supported a number of health awareness and prevention programs, including the American Society Relay for Life of Willingboro, where she served as planning committee chairperson for two consecutive years. Reverend Williams holds a bachelor's degree in English from the University of Delaware, a Master of Communication and Information Studies from Rutgers University, and a Master of Divinity from Palmer Theological Seminary, and four units of clinical pastoral education from the University of Pennsylvania Health System. Committed to Christ's missions to seek and save the lost, Reverend Williams firmly believes and promotes through her preaching, teaching, and lifestyle that God's love is unconditional. No matter the depth of her sin, the sentiment is best expressed in one of her favorite passages of the scripture, Romans chapter 8, verses 38 through 39. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, or any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So the next voice that you'll hear following the next sermonic selection will be that of Reverend Janiqua Williams. So church, repeat after me, extend your hand forward. Reverend Williams, Preach the word.
Preach the
word. Reverend Williams,
we need a word.
Amen.
Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I see some people out there got some unspeakable joy. I see some people out there got some smiles on their faces. They know what the Lord has done for them. They know that the Lord has been good. They know that his mercy endures forever. If you got joy unspeakable, I need you to stand up in this house today if you are able and just praise the Lord right now. Praise him for this moment right now. I don't know what you got to go home to or what you left coming here, but we're going to praise the Lord for his goodness and his mercy right now. Hallelujah. Glory to the Most High God. Glory to the Most High God. The word tells us that his joy is our strength. Hallelujah. If you need some strength today, you need to leap for joy this morning, church. Hallelujah. Ain't he good? Ain't he good? Hallelujah. Yes, he is. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. God is good. And all the time. Yes, he is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, choir. Let's give the choir a round of applause and praise to our God and the good thing that they are doing here. To our musicians, y'all know y'all on fire, and it's tight and it's right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to give glory and honor and praise to my God, my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ, who woke me up this morning. Sickness tried to be in my body, but you ain't even know that song was speaking to me before I got here. The joy of the Lord gave me strength. My mom knows it, and the devil had to stand to the side because the Lord intended for me to be here today. So I thank God today for allowing me to be here. I want to thank Dr. Allen in her absence. She knows that I'm praying for her, and I'm praying with you all for her. Thanking her for the invitation. Thanking you for welcoming me here. Thanking my mother, Sister Sandra Jenkins, for journeying with me and being my number one intercessor and prayer warrior. I bring you greetings from Parkway Baptist Church in Willingboro, New Jersey, where my pastor is the Reverend Dr. Lawa L. Gill, thanking him for so graciously allowing me to be here today and to serve with you this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know we had the word read, but I like to read the word myself and just internalize it once more before we go on. So if you don't mind standing in reverence and honor to the word of God just one more time, I appreciate you so much for that. Hallelujah. We're going to be reading from Genesis, the 12th chapter. I'll be reading in your hearing verses 1 through 4 in the NIV. And it reads, "The Lord had said to Abram, 'Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you.' So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left. He set out from Haran." Hallelujah. "The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever." Hallelujah. You may be seated. I want you to pray with me this morning as I share a little bit about facing an unknown place. Facing an unknown place. I'm one of those types of people that when I'm driving anywhere, if I'm driving to the supermarket, around the corner in the area, if I'm driving a great distance especially, I always use GPS. Anybody else in here? I always use the GPS because I'm comfortable with that system. And I like the idea of having a system that knows where I'm going better than I know. Even if I've been there 1,000 times, the GPS knows what lies ahead. The GPS sees what's around the corner, knows what's going on with the traffic patterns, knows what's going on with the weather-related construction issues. The GPS knows. So I'm really confident in it, and I make sure that I always use it because I'm comfortable with it. Well, one day as I was driving, I happened to glance down at the GPS monitor attached to my car there, and I saw these words, and I heard it come through, an unknown road. Have you ever seen that on your GPS? An unknown road was prominently displayed there on the screen. Now, when most of us think about something that's unknown, we think about the idea of something being unfamiliar, something being new, something being foreign or different, mysterious, or maybe even strange. When we're venturing out into an unknown experience, many of us have feelings of worry, frustration, anxiety, and sometimes even fear. Even if we feel like the place that we're moving into is an exciting opportunity, something that even God intended for us to move into, something new and different, and a mystery that we have to unravel, a new business that we're moving into, even if we think that what lies ahead just might be something good for us, there's still a little bit of apprehension as we move forward into this unknown place. Amen? Amen. I'm not the only one. Okay. Well, in this morning's text, God tells Abram to leave his home, his family, and everything that he has ever known and go to a place the word says that God will show you. He says, I will show you. Now, I don't know about all of you, but if you remember your first grade language arts class, they didn't even call it English. It was your language arts class. That's the future tense. That means it hasn't happened yet. I would have been more comfortable for myself if God had given me the name of a place that I'm driving to. Like the GPS maps out everything and every place I'm going. But he told him, go to a place that I will show you. God was sending Abram off. He was going down a road that he never traveled before, a destination that he had yet to even know he was going to. And he was going to an unknown place. Church, there comes a time in everyone's life when God calls each of us into an unknown place. Our friend Abram was 75 years old when God told him to leave everything that he had ever known and journey to this unknown place. And that's proof that it really doesn't matter how long you live on earth. Whether you're a high school senior or a senior citizen, God can lead you into some unknown places in your life. Things that you've never seen, never heard, or never experienced before. Amen. If you don't believe me, just remember COVID. Something we never saw, we never heard, and we thought we would never have to experience in this life. But God led us into that unknown place. For some of us, maybe you're taking a new job. Maybe you're going off to college. You got kids going off to college, grandkids going off to college. Some people are moving up a grade this fall, and they have to get used to a whole new set of people. They have to get used to a whole new place, a whole new set of things. That's an unknown place. Maybe you've grown accustomed to having your family, your friends, your church members all around you, but they're all gone now. You have different people in your midst, or just the loss of those who were with you. That's an unknown place. Or maybe you've been managing your own affairs for so long, taking care of yourself, but you find yourself in a position in life where you have to rely heavily on the help, the assistance, the aid of other people. That's an unknown place. And the list goes on and on of all the different things we could find ourselves encountering. Now, the text doesn't say to us that Abram hesitated or that he was concerned at all where God was sending him, why God was sending him to this unknown place. But I know as long as we're living and breathing and we're on this earth, we're human. Amen. We're human. And each one of us fears a little. We might have a little bit of anxiety today if God were to tell us to pick up everything that we've ever known and move out into an unknown place. For many of us, the fear might come upon us so heavily as we go out into this unknown place that we feel paralyzed, and it might even halt our forward movement, even if what lies ahead is a good thing. But but something that God is leading us to, even if we're happy about that thing, can still cause us fear. Whether God has given us the spirit of fear or not, and we know he hasn't, we still see the idea of facing an unknown place as something that can shake us to our core. Whether we do it quietly and no one else is watching, or we do it out loud, even the strongest among us. Reverend Warren, I don't care what our title is. I don't care, Deacon Harris. I don't care where we've been or how long we've been on this earth, whether we educated or whether we got money or not. If God is sending us into something new, it's going to shake us just a little bit. Amen. So the question I have for you today is, how do we walk into an unknown, unfamiliar, and uncomfortable place to us? How do we go where we've never journeyed before? How do we go and do what we've never done before? How do we walk into our unknown places in life when God has called us there? Well, my sisters and brothers, I believe in the text that Abram has left us just a couple of lessons, and I want to share those with you today. First, when he was facing his unknown place, Abram believed God. Abram believed God. He believed that God was true, and he took him at his word. Now, what's funny about this is because at this point in the text, Abram doesn't really know who this God was. In our text, we find Abram, which means an exalted father, a man who was later named Abraham, the father of many nations. And as we know, Abraham's faith was considered so great that God accounted it to him as righteousness. But at this point in the text, we just have Abram, little old Abram, a man whose family had come from the Ur of Chaldeans, and they worshiped the moon and other false gods. This Abram. Now, I can imagine that this man who worshiped these idols, this Abram, was quite surprised to receive a personal message from God. A personal message, even if it had come from any other God, had to be startling to him. Because the gods of his people were idols, distant idols, objects of worship. And they didn't personally interact with humans because they weren't real. But the Lord, the true and living God, reached out from heaven and initiated a conversation with Abram. Has God ever initiated a conversation with you? Has God ever spoken to you in a dream? Has he ever spoken to you in a word, in a message from a preacher? Has he ever spoken to you in a time of prayer? Has God ever spoken to you in the quiet of your own heart, in that still, small voice? Spoken to you. It can be a quite alarming experience, whether it's in an audible voice or not, to hear something that you know is coming from something beyond you, something that has power. And for those of us who know God, knowing that it's coming from God, it can be quite an alarming experience. It happened this way to Abram, even though he really didn't know God at this point. But God was calling him into relationship, calling him into ministry, calling him to an unknown place. Now, I'm sure that Abram had some doubts and some fears about what he heard. He's human. Amen. Yet when he heard the voice of the Lord, Abram chose to believe. He chose to believe that this God was God, and that what he said was indeed possible, that he could actually accomplish what he spoke to him. Something about this God that he heard made a difference to Abram. Something about this God that he heard rang true in Abram's ears. Have you ever had that experience with somebody else, a loved one, your mother, your father, a husband, a wife, family, friend, shared something to you to encourage you, but it didn't speak to you quite the way you needed at that time, and you didn't feel like you could move from that place, but then you heard a word from the Lord, and something about that word spoke to you differently. Something about that voice communicated differently to you, and you knew that it was the true and living God. I believe, church, that that's the experience that Abram had here, which is why he could believe this God that he had never heard, this God who was possibly one among many of the gods that he worshiped, but this God spoke to him and caused him to move. He believed this God. And I'm telling you that we need to believe God like this too. I don't care how long you've been in church, saints. Sometimes we get a little rusty in our ability to hear God clearly, our ability to trust God, even though we know who God is. We need to believe God, especially when we're facing unknown places in our lives. We need to do exactly what Abram did and believe who God is. The word tells us in Hebrews 11:6, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. The Bible tells us many other stories of people who believed God and took him at his word for provision, for protection, for healing, for deliverance, and for so much more. Blind Bartimaeus was willing to look like a fool because he believed God. The woman with the issue of blood was willing to face ridicule and a potential stoning because she was an unclean woman in the public setting. She did this because she believed God. Peter could step out of the boat and walk on water, something not a single one of us in this room would have done, but he did it because he believed God. Saints, some of us don't see God's blessings in our life. We don't see what God wants for us, the things that he's spoken to us in our midnight hour. We don't see those things come to pass because we really don't believe God. We have a relationship with him, amen, through Jesus Christ. But do we truly believe that he is who he says he is and he can do exactly what he says he can do? We need to believe God and trust that despite the fact that things are going on in our life, despite the information, the reality of the world in front of us, that this God has all power in his hands and this God can do something about it. This God can step into our family situations when our loved ones are sick, our kids are wayward, all kinds of things are going on in the home, and he can make a difference because he has all power in his hands. This God can step into all that mess going on in the government, and he can turn things around because he has the heart of Pharaoh in his hands. And if he wants to, he can turn that heart. And Pharaoh will speak the words, let my people go. Because this God is God. Hallelujah. We know so much more than Abram and all of those knew. We have the full testament of scripture, the history of the world, and our own personal testimonies to stand on. We know for a fact that God is El Shaddai, the Almighty God. We know for a fact that God is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who healeth thee. We know for a fact that he is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. We know for a fact that God is Jehovah Shammah, the Lord who is present with us. He is Jehovah Shalom, the Lord, our peace. We know that he is a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper, a light in the darkness of this world. We know these things. We've experienced these things. We need to believe them. We need to dive into the word each and every day. We need to go down on our knees, even if your knees creak and hurt every time you get down. We need to get down and we need to communicate with this true and living God so he can remind us of who he is and show us what he can do for us in the midst of everything that's going on with us. Hallelujah to the Lord our God. Hallelujah to the Lord our God. I won't keep you long. I promised Dr. Allen that I wouldn't. So the one more thing that I want to share that we learned from this passage that Abram did that can help us when we're facing our unknown places is that Abram was able to move. He stepped out on faith when he believed that this was God, he stepped out on faith. The word of God tells us in Hebrews that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith sees what could be. It sees what might be, even though something else might be our reality. Amen. Faith sees invisible things, unknown things. And God commands that we walk by faith and not by sight, not by our circumstances, not by what's going on in our life, not by what he said, she said, and they said, but by what God said. That's what we're commanded to do. And when we walk by faith, the word tells us that we please God, for it's impossible to please him without faith. And it's impossible to have faith without believing. The two go hand in hand. Now, I know that walking by faith, church, is a risky business, especially when we're facing some mess, some unknown stuff that we never thought we would see ourselves in and that we really don't want to go into. It gets really risky. And most of us are afraid to step out on faith when we're moving into the unknown. Fear forces us to play it safe, to stay within our comfort zone. But the word tells us that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Just rest right there. Power. He has given us power to walk by faith, power to change circumstances in our life, power to do whatever it is that God told us to do. Now, I'll tell you this. God doesn't want any weak, good-for-nothing, lukewarm Christians. Amen? I'm not saying that's anybody here at Second Baptist. That's not nobody here, right? Amen. He doesn't want that. God makes it very clear in the word that you have to trust and obey him. You either do or you don't. In fact, he said he would rather you be hot or cold instead of sitting on a fence, scared to put your faith into action. This is in Revelation. This is the word of God. He wants you there or not at all. Amen. He wants you to have faith or not have it at all. Now, he'll work with you if you have little faith and he'll build it. But having a little faith is having faith. Amen. But sometimes we get so far away from God, we pull away from God because of our lifestyle, the things that we are in, the people that we allow in, the things we allow in our eye gates and our ear gates, that we begin to walk back on our faith. But God wants us to step up boldly and embrace the faith that he has given to us so that we can do all that he has called us to do. Jesus died so that we can have life and have it more abundantly now and in eternity. He rose with all power in his hands, and that same resurrection power is living on the inside of us, so that we can walk out this faith life. We can live according to the way God said we should live. And when we walk by faith and not by sight, we see the power of God working through us. Working through us. Amen? Amen. It's the truth. You need to look at some of these people in the Bible who have done awesome and great things in the name of the Lord. People, flesh and blood, just like us. They ain't something different just because they in the Bible. If the Bible was written in this time, it would be you, me, Reverend Warren, Dr. Allen. Our names would be in there. The only thing that's different is they were in that time, we're in this one. The God that we serve, the God who gives us the power to walk by faith. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And if we believe in him and we walk by faith, he will work in and through us to will and to do everything that he has called us to do. The Holy Spirit is right here, right now, in our midst, in each and every one of us who know Christ. He's reminding us of who God is and how God has promised to help us whenever we put our faith in action. That's why Abram was able to risk going into an unknown place. He remembered heard the promises that God made to him. God promised that he would bless this man and his descendants. He said, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. And you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. And whoever curses you, I will curse. So he didn't even have to worry about his haters. He didn't have to worry about his haters. We're so upset and worried about all the things that people are trying to do behind our back and on Facebook. God said, if you do what he said to do, you walk by faith, he gonna handle them too. So you don't even have to worry about all that. He said, I will curse those who curse you, and all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. And Abraham is the father of our faith. So these blessings that are promised here to him, they carry on to each and every one of us who are his children through faith in Jesus Christ. Abram didn't know where God was sending him or what would happen along the way, but he took hold of the promises of God. He took a leap of faith, and the Bible says that Abram never wavered in believing God's promise. In fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this, he brought glory to God. Don't you want to bring glory to God? Don't you want to bring glory to God? Well, you walk by faith. Don't worry about whether you can do it. God can do it. I know somebody in here has received a promise from God at one point or another. Well, I want to encourage you to put your faith into action, because that's what God's waiting on to move in your life. That's what God needs to move in my life. He wants us to step out on faith, people of God. Every single time we step out on faith and we do what God has called us to do, like Abram did, God shows up. He promises that he will never leave us nor forsake us. So even in the midst of trying times, even in the midst of problems, he's right there. But I guarantee you, you step out on faith, God will show up. Hallelujah. He showed up for the Israelites when they were stuck between the Egyptians and the Red Sea. He showed up for David when he was facing Goliath. He showed up for Daniel in the lion's den. He showed up for the three Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace. He showed up for Queen Esther when she stood before her husband, the king. He showed up for Jesus, hallelujah, when Satan thought he had him beat on Calvary's cross. He showed up, he showed up, he showed up. He showed up for them, and he'll definitely show up for you. He showed up for me this morning when I was sick and worried that I wasn't even going to be able to make it. But the women on a prayer call prayed me through, and just like that, God showed up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's because he is God, and he has the power to make a difference in our lives. He has a power to come through for us, but he is asking for us to do our part. He just wants us to have a little bit of faith. If you put that little bit of faith in action, trusting and believing who God is, you put that little bit of faith in action, he starts to move. He starts to do things. You start to recognize what he can do. And that faith starts to grow. And it starts to grow. And it starts to grow to the point where we are like those people in the Bible, turning the world upside down for Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Church, I don't know about you, but I have been young, and now I'm a little bit older. But I know this, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. When we believe God and we begin to walk by faith, we can encounter our unknown places. Whatever they are for you, you get that in mind, what your unknown place is today. We can encounter those things with hope. This eager anticipation that God is going to show up and bless us. Hope reminds us that God is bigger. He's bigger than those devils coming against you at work. Hallelujah. He's bigger than that sickness in your body. He's bigger than your financial problems. He's bigger than the issues in your family and your relationship. He's bigger than anything that could ever come up against you, because he is God. Let that sit for you for a minute. Let that sit for a minute. He is God, and he is no one like no one else. No one is like him. And I know that when we hope in the Lord, we win every single time. It may take a little bit longer for some things to transpire. The Lord decided to make my sickness go away this morning, but there have been times when I had to wait for my healing to come. But that's all right. He always showed up, and I continue to have hope that he would do it. You have to believe God and step out on faith, and that hope is going to come. The hymn writer says it like this: my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground. Any situation you find yourself in, you can't rely on your finances. You can't rely on Tom, Dick, and Harry and somebody. You have to rely on Jesus. That's the only solid rock, the only thing that's steady. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give him praise and glory in the house today, saints. Hallelujah. I'm finished. I'm done. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 There may be somebody out there, if we could all stand, there may be somebody here who hasn't yet met the true and living God. You've been coming to church. You've been singing. You've been praising. You know some family members. I'm not going to put people out there, but sometimes you got titles and positions too. But you still have not come into relationship with the true and living God. We look all pretty and gussied up in church on Sunday. Turn around on Monday and living like all kinds of hell. It may not be anybody here at Second Baptist, but sometimes that's the case. And I don't say this to condemn anybody, but we need Jesus. Jesus knows that we're messed up. That's why the word tells us, for God so loved the world, this messed up sinful flesh, that he sent his only begotten son, that whoever shall believe on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. If that's you today, if you have not made that decision to come to Christ for yourself, we are asking you to come on down to this altar this morning with these good people, and I can pray for you and trust and believe that if that's you, the Lord will not only meet you here, he's already there with you and will walk you down this aisle, because he wants you in his family. Jesus wants to be your Lord, your Savior. Hallelujah. He wants to see you working and doing the things that he's called you to do. He wants you to be able to stand up in faith and power against everything that the enemy could bring against you. But the only way you're going to do that is if you have the true and living God in your corner, and that means you have to have Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to God but by Jesus. Without Jesus, we have no relationship with God. Hallelujah. Is there anyone else? Anyone else coming to Jesus? Okay, hallelujah. Is there anyone then? We're going to open the doors of this church. I've been given permission to do that. If there's anyone here who would like to unite with Second Baptist Church of Asbury Park, you don't have a church home, maybe you've been coming here for a while, you just haven't decided that you want to join. Well, now is the time. Now is the time. Come on and join these good people so that you can be together working to build the kingdom of God. It's a beautiful and amazing thing that happens when men and women of God come together in the house of God to do the work of God. God blesses it. God blesses it. Is there anybody here who would like to unite with this church? If there is, come on down. Come on down. Again, we're not trying to call you out. We just want to love on you. We just want to love on you. We want to wrap our arms around you and say welcome. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Anyone else want to unite with this church? Or maybe you're still thinking about whether you want to be saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can wait. We got time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The word tells us that all the angels in heaven rejoice when one sinner comes to Christ. Hallelujah. It happened for me. It happened for everyone who believes. And we're so happy that we're going to be with Jesus forever. Anybody else, we want you to be in the family of God with us. We love you either way, but we want you to be there with us in glory when Jesus comes back for his church. Is there anyone else? Anyone else for salvation? Anyone else for membership in this house of worship? Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you, church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we give you glory and honor and praise for the new souls, God, that have come into the kingdom or into this house of worship. God, the angels rejoice, so we rejoice with them today, God. We who have been down that path understand, God, just how important it is for us to unite with you and to unite with the house of worship where we can grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and where we can work out our soul salvation day by day. Father, we pray your blessings be upon them, Lord God, as they go from this place to where they will be worked with and prayed for. God, help them to mature into the believers that you have called them to be. And God, hallelujah, watch over their lives, because we know the enemy is mad. Watch over them, Lord God, but we thank you that now there is no weapon formed that will be able to prosper against them, because they are the righteousness of God. They are the children of the Most High God. Bless and keep them, Lord God. Keep them, draw them closer and closer to you, Lord God, and help them to walk in the way everlasting. We pray your blessings be upon this church, Lord God, and all that they do for your glory. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, and we praise you. Amen.
Well, church, we all know we're going to that unknown place, and we thank you, Reverend Williams, Reverend Janiqua R. Williams, for bringing us to that unknown place and letting us know that it's not hard to go there. So as we get ready to go out today, I ask Reverend Williams to please lead us in benediction. Now, thank you. We want to acknowledge those who came forth today for prayer. Name?
Izzy. My name's Izzy.
Izzy. Okay. Uncle Dan. Yeah, I know. I know Uncle Danny's up here. And I think the other gentleman's name, please. Brother Creel. That's the Creel family from Asbury. Too far away from home. We welcome him to Second Baptist. And as we leave today, stop by and say thank God for those who step forward, if not for prayer, for joining the church, but our doors are open to everyone, Lord. And we know that, Lord, will protect us and guide us. So now we may have the benediction.
Let us all stand. Hallelujah. Once again, I thank you for allowing me to be here. I thank Dr. Allen in her absence. And I pray that God will be with you. Hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before his presence in his glory, be their majesty, dominion, and power, now and forevermore. Let everybody say together, amen.
And I say, God be with you. remember that God, He will be with you until we meet again. Keep on working, keep on working for, 'cause He'll be with you. If you hear, remember that God.